So, my name is Raúl Jiménez. I'm working since March 2014, 1 year and a half at Esri as developer program manager. In my position, I have to try to generate a community, organize events, help developers to understand our technology. I had the other day I received an email from Johan asking me, or suggesting a talk. He offered himself to come from Granada to give a talk about CartoDB, about Mapbox, sorry. Of course, I like the idea, so I told him that we could do it, and then he said,
Sí, tenéis nuestro teléfono, tanto el mío como el de mi madre.
hello.
13A, 5C.
Jansing, I'm going to mute
¿13A?
your mic. So he suggested to join with Jorge and me to give this talk. And yeah, I don't know, it's someone's camera. And that's it. I'm a software engineer. I studied computer science in Granada. And I'm based here since, I don't know, 3 years or something like this.
Well, I'm Jorge. I'm working at CartoDB for the last 5 months. So I joined in May, and I'm part of the solutions engineering team. So we try to help clients and customers, and mainly the salespeople to support on the technical part of the sales process and the post-sales process. Well, I'm from Valencia, and nowadays I'm supposed to be living in Valencia, but I'm spending more time in Madrid than in Valencia. But I'm trying hard to get back to Valencia. Well, formerly I'm a cartography engineer from the University of Valencia. I have a teacher here. Well, I think that's all.
So it's on screen sharing now.
Yeah.
Okay. So I don't need to adjust to. Okay. So hi, I'm Johan. I'm working at Mapbox since a year now. I'm a backend engineer, so I'm working on the infrastructure in the backend, the data processing pipelines, both for map data and for directions. I'm based in Berlin, and yeah, I'm happy to be here today. And I hope we can all learn something.
Sure.
Sure, we will. All those links, right?
Yeah.
Who want to be next? We are not that many, so I think we can spend a few minutes introducing ourselves. And of course, if you want guys in the Hangout on Air, you can introduce yourself too.
I'm Ramiro. I'm an environmental biologist, GIS analyst, and working for Paisaje Transversal. I'm also in a job in a NGO called Ombagua. That's something like Engineers Without Frontiers. And I'm also in the theaters. I don't know if the hashtag for this talk.
I don't know. We didn't set any hashtag actually, but GeoDev, for example.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
My name is Gustavo Romanillos. I'm an architect and urbanist by training, and I've been working with GIS and on the online maps for the last 5 years. I'm teaching at the university here and in London, and in a number of cooperation and research projects that are based in collaborative map making. I've been working mostly with RGs online, but I'm very interested also in the other two platforms. I know a little bit about CartoDB, and I have some light idea also about Mapbox, but not that much. So, okay, hope to learn something from that. Thank you.
Hi, this is me. I'm Bianca from Esri, Spain. I also work with some, well, sometimes I have some little things with Geo Inquietos from Madrid, but nothing from the last year. So I want to learn everything from you, from the expert.
Thank you, Bianca.
Thank you.
I already know Raul in person. The next, I think I have know Jorge from the last Jornadas de Cic Libre de Girona.
Uh-huh.
I think so. And I don't have the chance to meet Johan, but this is a good opportunity.
Yeah. So, Rafa, Mike, Pedro, someone here, introduce yourself.
My name is Luis Miguel. I am a geologist, and I work in the National Union in developing our keys. And I have a company with John. This is John. I used to work with Luismi. Make development of GS development of whatever the clients want to. So that's
all. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah. I'm Alfonso, and actually I work for a Google partner, for Google Maps partner, and do some developments on GIS, and basically visual applications and that. I'm coming just out of university and invited by John, okay?
Mm-hmm.
Someone else want to... Hello, Rafa.
Yeah.
Open your mic. Mike, open your mic.
Ah, you don't have, he doesn't have.
Ah, okay.
And he wants me to introduce him, Quietos Valencia, but it's just a for those that you don't know about Geo Inquietos are like micro local chapters or something like that, local groups on several cities on Spain and also in other Spanish spoken languages countries like in Buenos Aires and Mexico DF and also another one in Nicaragua, but most of them us are in Spain, and well, that's all. We do geobeers and workshops, and kind of the same of the geo developers, but more spread. Just yes, and that's all.
In
Valencia, we do geopaella also.
Yeah, geopaella is also nice. I recommend you to come next time.
My name is Sana.
Very interested in showing
the results from digital mapping. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
No one else? Yeah.
Hello, this is Fernando Quesada from Madrid. I'm an aerospace engineer, not really working with maps, but only some projects in mind, and very curious about that, so nice to see you.
Yeah, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Fernando, right? Yeah.
My name is Antonio. I'm a forestry engineer, but I'm working been working with GIS in many years, and I try to recover again my knowledge about GIS.
Great. Someone else? Do we start? Five.
No one else in the
four,
hangout want to present?
Three. Okay, so let's start because I think we have. Well, I don't know if someone told me that I have to run out soon. I don't want anyone to miss. Anyway, we are recording the session. We will upload it to the Geo Developer site. If someone doesn't know that site, just ask me later. Okay. So I'm going to be first. I'm going to start the timer, so I don't.
Shall we sit down in the first row?
Yeah. Well, no, you can stay here. Sure.
Oh.
Well, I just tried. Well, I recommend you to join to the first line now more than ever because I didn't notice that it was going to be so little. I tried to write down a little bit of the history of technologies, how they have been appearing since 2001. I think it's GeoServer is one of the first applications for to do or work with geographic data. And then we start coming. What I want to show or to notice here or show here is that we are becoming, well, we are having each year more and more tools and more functionalities. At the beginning, we just had like base maps and geocoding and routing. It was a really simple thing. But soon when Google Maps came to the game, he opened the Google Maps API and a lot of people started writing application with maps. I just want to give you an overview about the big ethos.
Milestones,
yeah. Where vector tiles appear, I think, probably Mapbox were the first introducing the vector tiles or well, probably Google did that before, but they didn't open or try to write a standard or popularize this kind of technology. And then Mapbox appeared and did that. We started having the vector tiles. Then with CartoDB and Torque, we start having more tools to show the data and to do nice animation. Then, well, in ArcGIS, we opened the story maps, which we will see later, and start opening the online spatial analysis, who wasn't available, I think, before. I'm quite new, so if you want to say something, just do that. I'm new to the development side. I have been, like I said, 1 year and a half. And then we started working on, or start appearing new technologies with 3D, with frameworks, with, well, some offline mapping. And now I think we are facing the challenge to work with smart mapping. Or this is the way we call it, when you upload data and we have algorithms who analyze the data and try to figure out which is the best symbology to represent the data. Now CartoDB is calling it a one-click map, I think. Mm-hmm. So I think we are facing now this kind of challenges. Well, I also wanted to give one step back and think that we have many kind of people using maps. Like we used to say, I think all of us, everyone is using maps right now. Some people is just checking direction or places who are maybe the less advanced users, but probably everyone who has an Android or an iPhone or a smartphone is checking directions. Then I think we have another segment or kind of people who are more advanced users who also upload data and they need tools to geolocate their data and to be able to see that data and share with other people. I'm thinking, for example, in Facebook, people are uploading pictures and placing in different different sites or whatever. And then we start having now professionals in using maps, like journalists, like people from the top management in different companies taking decisions from this data. They have, right now, they are start noticing that they have one tool or really important data that they can get some information from using with or mixing with geotechnology. So I think they also need more advanced tools, and then I place the more advanced user who are the GIS professional. Most of you, I think you are in there. So you need to make analysis, you need tools to do all the things. And I think in the online mapping, we are moving to all those fields. We are trying to fill all the needs on every segment. Probably our companies are focusing on different segments or doing different moves. So I just wanted to share a little bit of what we think is going to be trending and what we are doing to push in that direction. First of all, I think, well, storytelling and smart mapping is one of the things that are becoming popular. I think CartoDB is doing a great job there also, helping people to understand that this is important. And we are also trying to do the same with all the story maps project. We have many templates and many pre-built applications that you can customize. And this is our bet, I don't know how to say, on this. Another thing we think it's going to be very trendy is the 3D. We have been working on that since last year or 1 year, maybe a little bit more, with the web scenes. So with our desktop application, you could publish the web scenarios, but now with the JavaScript API, with the 4.0, we are working on that, and you can see the example in the top is done with a JavaScript API, so it's already working. I really like the idea of 3D mixing the relief and the buildings all at the same time. Is what you can see on this example from Girona. Yeah, it's I think it's really cool to see. As I saw here, which application I think it will have, like urban planning, or as we used to call it, geodesign, tourism, indoor routing, or as you can see here, you can also build and get into a building in 3D with web technology. It's really cool to share all that kind of information. Indoor mapping, I think everything related to indoor geolocation and indoor mapping is going to be trendy. And in Esri, we are also doing a lot of things in that way, where, as you can see here, you can start doing building or your addressing, you can start analyzing all this data. For that, right now, we have all the ArcGIS Online and ArcGIS Server APIs who can perfectly work with all this data. Another trend that I think we will see, and we are already doing some things with that, and with Fiverr. I don't know if you know Fiverr from Telefonica. It's an Internet of Things European project. So we are also working with them, taking information from buses moving on Santander, from sensors in Sevilla, and trying to give that information in real time to take decisions, to do better routine planning to pick up the trash or the recycling. Also for, as you can see here, for natural disaster response, I think we have seen many things on this topic too. And we have tools to work with Hadoop to make that possible. We have this example with IBM Watson, which is another tool who is a smart tool and try to get knowledge from the data. In this case, was analyzing the reaction from the public to different advertisement on TV. Well, I just wanted to share with you this slide so you can have it when you get back home. This is the tools we already have. I have been talking about some of them. I also had added here Coop and ArcGIS Open Data, which I think it's also really important in the web mapping ecosystem to share the data. Coop is a really nice tool to try to get together all the geolocated information and expose all this information on different formats. Like you can bring some information from CCAM portals. Well, I don't know if you know, it's an open source portal for open data. You can bring it to the tool and then serve it in CSV, in GeoJSON, in feature service, so you can work in different platforms with it. And it is included in the ArcGIS Open Data platform. So everything you publish on the ArcGIS Open Data, it's available in different formats, so you can work with it in wherever you want. I just wanted to encourage you to open, of course, a free developer account if you don't have it to be able to try most of these tools. And just to finish, I didn't know if all of you were going to know who we are. So the slides I like to show is this one. Esri is a multinational company who was founded by Jack Dangermon, as I like to call him Uncle Jack. In 1969, but here in Spain, the company was found in 1991. Well, the company actually, I think it's quite big. In Spain, we are 80 people. Here we have two colleagues in the room, and Jansa and Pedro is also in the hangout. And we are really open to watch you or to welcome you to our conference. That will be in 2 weeks. So if you want to join us, of course, you are more than welcome. That's it. I'm finished, so Jorge, please.
Let's see, because this is a Mac, and Macs and me are not that friends. I tried for 5 months, but... I'm going to do a brief overview, a technical overview of Car2DB and explain what Car2DB is or comes from. And maybe we can discuss a little bit of the components, but it's more about technical stuff. So, well, no maps on this talk, so because it's about technical components, but no, it's false. There are some maps. First of all, we are hiring. For sure, Esri is hiring, but we are hiring also. So if you are interested in working with us, just go to the webpage and check the positions, because maybe you fit in one of them, and I encourage you to do it because it's a good company to work with. Car2DB started not as Car2DB. Javier de la Torre and Sergio Leiva started Visuality in April 2008, and it was a visualization company. It was a company working not just on geospatial projects, but on all kinds of visualizations, but most of them in the geospatial field. And for every project, they did the same. They did the same stack, the typical stack that you have your database, then you have your rendering engine, whatever it is, and then some APIs to provide the services that the client code needs to have the data in the browser or reporting or whatever. So, and they have to do all the time, as in any consultancy I used to do also. So, and they try to create a component or a product that they could reuse as an internal product. And that was the first. That was the beginning of Car2DB. Well, the mascota, the puppet of Car2DB is Cartofante, Cartofant, and it's an elephant in a cloud. It's a balloon. And well, it's Cartofante. And well, that's the beginning in 2011 of the product. And the mission of the company and the product is to democratize location intelligence, to bring this kind of visualization, usually complex components and stack to everyone, so everyone can join to the platform or use the product because it's open source, and use it to get insights of your data, not just visualizing a data set, but also getting something more from your geographical information. And nowadays, the company, talking about the company, it's a venture capital company. We are more or less 70 people and growing. We have 130,000 users. And it's an open source product, so you can download everything from our repos and install it on your servers if you want to. But you can rely on us if you want to have a full support, of course, because we are a service company. And Car2DB as a product, it's a full stack product. So you start from, it's not just a middleware or a database, but it's everything. It's a database with a middleware and the components to get your data on your browser. But what most of people understand as Car2DB is just as a mapping editor. No? So you have a web interface where you can create your maps, but it's way more. I will talk about this in a moment. Well, as a platform, we are integrated with Twitter, with Mailchimp, with Digital Globe, with different data services that provide your data into a map, so you can have maps of your Mailchimp campaigns, for example. You know, Mailchimp is a very popular newsletter service. We have integration with location-based services like Mapbox or Nokia Here or Google. So we don't do routing, but Mapbox does. So we integrate with them, for example. Or our platform is open enough to be integrated with them. And we have a Car2DB without the partners. It's not possible because we need experts to bring these tools to different clients that are not geospatial experts, so we rely on a more than 80 partners network to do the projects. Well, that's some example of maps very quickly. You probably know about the Twitter. Some people are sick of these maps, but because it's not that fancy maybe anymore, but and sometimes they don't make any sense, but sometimes they do. So it's interesting. Maybe you know this map that from the Mobile World Congress 2012 that exposed the difference of the transactions of the week before the conference and the week of the conference of the tourists, all the credit cards operations, and that was a way to sell the conference to the Barcelona City Hall. The New York City Mayor's Office is using also us to get insights of what's happening in the city, and also on the you have seen for sure election maps from Car2DB, and they are becoming more and more popular, and we are very happy of that. And finally, for example, this is a very nice project, and you have the video and the slides on the Girona GIS free GIS conference from a partner called Deimos, and they did a very nice project integrating with GRASS and many other open source tools to get those orange coverage maps. So we can talking about very briefly about the architecture of the Car2DB. First, we have the editor. Yes, that's the main software component that you are maybe used to use, but Car2DB is a platform. It's a special database where you store your data. Internally, we have a NoSQL database to store some configuration and so on. There are some backend tasks that they periodically happen, and we have some cache so the data is coming quickly to you. And finally, from the user's perspective, we have the editor, but also a JavaScript library, so you can create your own applications. Of course, all these applications are not right from the editor. The developers use a JavaScript library, so to interact with CatoDB and get the applications done. Well, about the components, just because you mentioned story maps, and we have Odyssey, that's a JavaScript library for storytelling, and that integrates with CatoDB, or not if you don't want to. It's a JavaScript library for storytelling, and we use as a web mapping frameworks, Leaflet or Google Maps, depending on your preference. But we support both of them. Everything here is open source, except just the resize to deploy the components, but everything is open source. And those in green are from us, because we are also supporting the PostGIS development and being in the front of that. And we use, of course, a lot of technology from Mapbox, like Carto CSS and Leaflet. Well, that's a typical cloud on CartoDB, just for the most technical one of you. I don't know. Most of you are, I think, for geospatial, so maybe you are not that interested in this. But just to tell you that I think nowadays CartoDB is like 100 servers, something like that. We have the most resource are occupied on the users' databases and on the rendering engines, and everything else is not that demanding on the backend side. And well, that's all. And I don't know if in time or.
I wasn't just writing. Writing notes, not checking
the. Well, I'm happy to answer any questions if you have, or maybe after the talk. Well, I think that's all. No, we're hiring. Just saying again, and all the links of the resources I've been talking about are here. So just you can go to this URL and everything is here. So just that's it.
I will integrate, if you don't mind, the slides both together.
Sure.
So Johan, your turn.
Okay. So. This is our website. Oh, I see you're logged in. Oh, cool. Then I can show. No, I can't search it. Okay. So, we're Mapbox. We are a platform for geo applications. The history of Mapbox is actually quite similar to the one of CartoDB, that at around 2003, our co-founders founded an agency which is called Development Seed, which is also still around today. And they started working for NGOs and governments, government agencies in the US. And they started doing websites and got more and more requests for web maps, and getting very specific requirements for web maps that were basically impossible to be fulfilled with the tools at that time. So around, I think, 2006, they started using TileStream, mm-hmm. which is an open source server that can serve your tiles. And they realized that they had to build the same infrastructure mm-hmm. over and over again for every project. And the step was quite easy to say, hey, we can bring this together. So they worked on TileStream 2 then, which I think 2009 or something. Started building, hosting more and more maps on the same infrastructure. And I think around 2011, they started seeing that they should move this into an own company. There's a big market demand for serving maps on the web. Mapbox was incorporated in 2012, I think, was bootstrapped until 2013, where the first round of funding came in, and we got another round of funding this summer. We are now 110 people globally, with main offices in Washington, D.C. and San Francisco. We also have a bunch of remote people in in Europe, so this is why I'm speaking here today. And we have two offices, one in Peru and one in India, that are specifically there to work with OpenStreetMap and work with open data and improve the data. So I'm going to talk about OpenStreetMap a bit as well, because it's also on my t-shirt. So we see ours, we don't have an end consumer product. I think it's kind of the same as Esri and as CarterDB. There's no Mapbox maps you can download on your mobile phone. And I think there likely will never be, also for you too, just because there's no money in that market. It's like impossible to make money with that, because Google and Apple have just cannibalized this. The way they make money is Apple makes money by selling devices and selling services on top of the devices. Google makes money on advertising. So both of them have an incentive to offer maps, but it's nothing that anyone would pay for. Or would you pay for a mapping app, $10 a month? Nobody. Mm-hmm. So instead, what we are, we're platforms where you can build geo applications on top. And we always internally say that we want to be the Lego set for geo applications. So we have all these parts of Lego that you can stick together and stick on top or on the side, and can combine with other Lego parts of other companies. Like you can load your data into ArcGIS and then export it and use Mapbox to display it on the web because you want to show it to many users. So maybe we talk about the differences later, and I'll just talk more about Mapbox first. Some examples. I'm just gonna show you some maps. Or if you're already like annoyed by maps, it's okay. Here's the dreaded. Here's a lot of tweets on the map. Twitter gave us the location data of 6 billion tweets, and we put it on a map. This is rendered out, so this is PNG tiles. This is not GL, this is not put on top. It's data that once it's rendered, you can't interact with anymore. Who can tell me which city this is? Yeah, I'll zoom out until you can see it. Okay. What we're taking advantage of is basically the cloud and being able to have immense power of processing to our purposes. We've done the same thing that you can see here with traces from Runkeeper, which is a running app that gave us, I think, 1.5 million traces. So a trace is always a number of points. These are very detailed information. So we get the points, the lat and long, and we match this really down to the point. You can see where people run. This is one of the things we do, and for us, this is like very custom. We have to work on ingesting this data. This is what CarterDB tries to make really easy by just putting it in. We are specifically looking at doing this for data that is extremely wide, big data sets that are running in the gigabytes. So this map is tiles as raster images. It's PNG files. And PNGs, raster files tiles are out. They're not cool anymore. The thing that is cool is vector tiles. So who knows the difference between raster and vector tiles?
Who knows?
Okay, I'll explain. So a raster tile is an image. And it's an image that usually is quite big. You also have one tile for every coordinate and every zoom level. So when you look at the world in zoom level 0, this means you see the whole world. If you go down to, this is zoom level 13 now, So you can see a neighborhood. If you go to zoom level 18, you see a house, basically, a bit more than a house. And for each of these zoom levels, you have to render a tile, which means that when you want to zoom, you have to basically zoom with the zoom levels. So as you can see here, like it's not seamless. It happens on every zoom. It's like it loads more things and pixels up and looks ugly. You can't change the data. So in here, the runkeeper data is already rendered down into the image. We can't separate the base layer from the data anymore. And it would be cool to do that, because then we could, for example, toggle the amount of runkeeper data we show here. And so what we've worked on is vector tiles, which I think I have opened somewhere. For example, here. And what you can see is when you... the mouse wheel is disabled on this map. Ah, crap. But what you can see there is... now the demo is gone. This is not... I fucked up. Sorry. But the cool thing is that you can zoom seamlessly, and you're also able to blend the data that is in the vector tiles. You can like remove data, you can add data. Also, vector tiles are smaller. So we can transfer data, depending on how you build the vector tiles, they're smaller. We can transfer more data. This is especially important on mobile phones. And another cool thing that you can do with GL is you can tilt the map and you can overlay more information, which is something that with raster tiles you could do before, but you actually need a kind of graphics, it's a GL context, or graphic library context, kind of the same thing how video games are rendered. This is the same thing how we are now displaying these maps. Okay. Being open and being Mapbox. Our questions so far to raster and GL? I think we'll come back to GL a lot anyways.
I just opened the microphone, the
speaker. So, okay, I'm going to talk about openness a bit. How much time do I still have?
I'm not counting, but...
Okay. Let's go on. So, when Mapbox was started, it was bootstrapped for a long time. This means all the money that funded Mapbox only came from doing consulting gigs. Basically, Mapbox worked for a client, got some money, worked a bit on the innovation on the side, and then had to do another client to pay the bills. Only recently we started getting funding. Actually, we got a lot of funding, I think, which is really good. On the other hand, it's really not that much money when it's about maintaining map data. There is, depending on the calculations you believe, Google and here and TomTom are paying about $1 billion per year to maintain their maps by licensing data, by sending people out, by processing the data. They have to have thousands of people on staff to work with that data. And we had, like, we were like 10 people. we didn't have this money. So the thing that actually enabled Mapbox to exist was OpenStreetMap. So the Wikipedia of mapping data, where basically everyone can put in map data. And it sounds like a scary thing in the beginning, because why would people not add and vandalize everything all the time? History has shown that it works really well, and all the data you've seen so far here has been open data, has been data that was created by the OpenStreetMap contributors, and that is occasionally correct. We don't only work with OpenStreetMap, but we also contribute back. As I said, we have teams in Peru and in India who their whole job is working with OpenStreetMap data. There are certain things that OpenStreetMap doesn't have. Geocoding is a problem. Searching for an address, there's no address data in OpenStreetMap. OpenStreetMap generally is good for all the things that are visual, and all the things that are data and that you need to work with geo are not so good in OpenStreetMap. So what we founded is the Open Addresses initiative, which tries to collect open data sets from governments, like address data, and make them available in one canonical format. And Yeah, this is like one push. So the other thing about being open for us was that we very much relied on open source to build our platform, but also started open source projects that other people can use. The biggest thing here is the GL rendering engine that you're seeing here, and the GL specification with it. Everything that was around creating this new geo standard was completely open. The development happens in the open, and we've seen other companies pick this up, this work, and contribute back as well. So this has been highly successful for us. I think at the moment there is... I just think we're the best rendering engine. Apart maybe from Google Maps, but they don't develop in the open, and you basically are to the peril of Google to see whatever happens with that. Our attitude towards open source is kind of the same thing as CarterDB. We open source the core things. The things we don't open source are how we run our service. So our server infrastructure and our delivery, because it's highly customized to the way we work. Okay, how we make money. If you wanna... If you wanna get started with Mapbox, there's free accounts that you can use, and you basically only have to pay the moment your map gets popular or the moment you use it for a commercial purpose. We are charging people on map views, how much they use. We also have geocoding, and we have directions that are also charged. In a way, since all the things are open source, you can kind of set this up yourself. But we are very sure that you don't want to do this. You don't want to set up your own tile server, and you don't want to have own infrastructure to run your maps to always have them be displayed, because it is actually hard, and there's a reason why these two agencies founded own companies to start this as cloud applications. Okay, I think I'm done already. I think this. I can see. I think I have another tab that we can look at. Oh yeah, we can look at this one. So to see kind of how this Lego principle can work, I think I should restart this tab. So this is a demo we built where we pull in a lot of our APIs. We pull in rendering things on a map in real time. We pull in our directions API, and so this simulates having a lot of couriers that have to pick up parcels in New York City and deliver them somewhere. And this is a thing that can run totally in your browser, but at the same time, this can also happily run on your server as much as you need it. As an example, this is the things that we hope to achieve, that our customers are able to plug and play all the parts that they need, and we do the heavy lifting. What you do is you write the glue code between all the moving parts to get it to work. So you don't have to think about how does routing actually work. You have to think about, once I have a route, what am I going to do with it? Okay, I think that's good for now.
Okay, I think this is the time you start asking questions if you want, or we can start discussing about a topic you think it's interesting, right? Mm-hmm. Or
nowadays, I still see some clients that they still want to put their data on their servers. Mm-hmm. Not use cloud service or something like that. As far as I know, I think that, well, with, for example, with your portal and what Catalan, you can create your custom Catalan your service, I think.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know about Mapbox, but it's, well, for example, we are working today for a big company that they finally wanted to create from zero a platform to for manage layers and documentation. And about that, solutions like K3B and what, how, or the question is, what I must tell these clients
To use the cloud?
Yes, or not use the cloud.
Or to use K3B or
yes,
MapBox.
Or maybe how hard is to create your custom K3B or
That's a very common question because mainly the people that comes from the geo world are very used to have their own server, their own like ArcGIS server or geo server, map server. And for us, from a technical point of view, there are a few corner cases to have K3B in your own, it's called an on-premise installation, and there's because maybe you want to integrate with your own authentication system, for example, you want to integrate with your own company way of leading with your roles and groups, and so, but that's a corner case for a normal clients, but not for the big clients. And for normal clients, the reason to have it on premise is for legal reasons or security reasons, because they don't trust the, or they are not allowed by the requirements of the project to get the data out of their own the in-house. And the K3B as an on-premise is a product that we sell. So and it's way more expensive than the normal cloud. Why? Because the support for that kind of product is hard, because you don't have access normally to the network, and you have to maybe be on call or have to go to the client and that's way more expensive than attending and maintaining your own infrastructure. But we have some big clients that have to be that, it has to be that way, because maybe even the server is not allowed to connect to the outside. So the server is completely isolated. Maybe you need like in the States, they have the security clearance to get into the facilities, and that's a really normal scenario on very specific clients. But on the other hand, if you want, and that's something that Johan was mentioning, that when if you don't have the money but you have the time or the skills, you can set up your K2DB and MapBox products in your house if you have the time to maintain it. But it's very hard to maintain. No, maybe it's easy to. It's not that hard maybe to install, but to maintain it updated with the changes that the people the techies are putting into the product is not that easy. So for us, it's always the same argument. This is like, well, if you have the time, you can go with your K3B product and you can maybe contribute back even if you want to. But if you don't have the time and you have the money, just contact us, because it's going to be easy for everyone, because we do support for the open source product. But it's like you are on your own. You have your own, the product, you have your, because we don't know which is your operating system, which is your how you are changing maybe the version of the Postgres, or who knows. So
so we also have the same on-premise an on-premise server that is called MapBox Atlas. The pricing is magnitudes higher than for the normal product. The reason is the support reasons. It's very hard to maintain for us, and it takes a lot of support. The reason why we can offer web mapping so cheaply, the way we do it, is because of economies of scale. So we are only 100 people in a way, but we can run this big platform. If we would have to hire 1,000 more people, then we would have to make more money, obviously, to pay all these people. Also, running in the cloud for us is fairly cheap. So we also run on Amazon Web Services, everything. And we're able to make good use of all the money we have there. We offer MapBox Atlas as well to start in AWS, because there, again, it's the same environment. So for us, it's fairly easy to get started there. We actually have MapBox Atlas in the AWS marketplace. So it's basically a one-click installation in your own or in your AWS account. which is kind of the middle ground between between on-premise but still to be in the cloud. The reason why people want to have this is usually not because they want to run a like high throughput map data for the public. If you want to do this, it makes sense to go to a public cloud provider like us or CartoDB and pay us the money that we think about how can this reliably scale to 50 million users. But it's usually security reasons. And with security, I see a big shift coming towards still using public clouds. So AWS has the government region now in the US, which is very compliant. For there, they might open something up similar in Europe. They already have two regions in Europe. There has not been big security leaks happening on AWS that we know about. You can encrypt all your data in the cloud, so there's no reason
with the new happening of the Safe Harbor.
Everything gets more interesting as well. Yes.
I just want to say that you can also rely on Arch Online to host
your data. So I think it's a very clear divide between three user groups here. There's the group that wants to have maps for the public in their product. Mm-hmm. They don't need to run their own infrastructure. Then there's the people who need to protect their data, but don't have the time to set things up themselves. Mm-hmm. And this is the people who want to use CartoDB on-premise or Mapbox Atlas. And then there's the people who are hobbyists and want to play around. And they can have the open source tools to play around and look under the hood and set things up themselves.
Any other topic question? I have a few things if you don't want to talk, so
don't be worried. I would like to talk about why do we even do maps on the web? Why do we have maps on the browser? And maybe I can just tell something about this. Mm-hmm. Kind of in the beginning, maps used to be like in applications on your computer, like ArcGIS. The problem is that running an application means you have to download the application and you have to run it on your computer and it has to work with your operating system. And the reason why we see this shift towards online with everything is because it works everywhere, nearly everywhere.
Yeah.
But if you have a modern browser, which most of the computers can have nowadays that you use, then you can also immediately have maps. And we first seen this shift in delivery of maps. Google Maps obviously kind of was the first big thing there for all the customers. But we're now also seeing this shift with making maps. So ArcGIS Online has been there. Mapbox is now working on, or we will release Mapbox Studio soon, which is an in-browser map styling tool.
Mm-hmm.
And the shift is definitely going more and more towards have everything in the browser. This also only works because browsers have become really, really fast in the last years. Computers have gone fast and browsers are fast today. So WebGL, the rendering, the fast rendering of the maps, of the vector tiles in the browser is something that only is possible since some years, since with the development of browsers, with having the WebGL APIs, and with CPUs being fast. So I would say that the move towards the web is something that we're gonna see continuously. And the only times where you need to run things on your own kind of home computer is when you want to do something very specialized that we can't do for you because we haven't built a product for it. But for all the kind of common cases, like the one click map, that's something that should just happen in the browser all the way.
Yeah, I agree that, well, we have been using maps since RGIS on the desktop, but also in paper. So we have been using maps all the time. And we want to share, and we have, I think all of us feel comfortable with geolocated data. You understand it better when you're seeing on a map. So I think it's becoming so popular because it's so useful that everyone
prefer to see the data in this way. Now, as you said, the browsers are becoming more powerful, and we can do more and more things, so it's going to getting bigger. It's time, like with all the 3D things, we are not used to see many 3D maps right now, but I'm sure that in 1 year or in 2 years, we will be flying over cities, watching 3D cities with virtual reality cardboards or whatever, and we will be experiencing new things that we have been always wanted to do, like to feel flying, or I think it's going to be possible all with web technologies, and it's really important because, as you said, it doesn't need to download in or install anything, and this is a key point from my point of view.
Yeah, we are not just on maps. We are moving out from email clients or web processing systems and many other common software that we were used to work with in 5 years ago. And now more and more everything is happening on our web. So it's being more relevant, the operating system you are working with, and it's being more easy to get more new users and new market. Mm-hmm.
The guys from the Hangout is asking us to repeat the question and say who is talking to recognize who is the one talking, because I'm going to stop the screen sharing. I'm going to share the webcam so you can see who is talking. Any other topic, question?
In the company area, we see that not only is the public, but also the mobility is a driver. Because some companies, maybe they are in the B2B environment, so they are not going to have millions of users.
Mm-hmm.
However, you might have a mobile workforce or whatever, the parents, that serving data maps from your own server. It's a nightmare because you have to take into account the security of the connections between the mobile and the central server, the VPN, and the cost associated with that. So there we see also a kind of opportunity for web mapping or for the same cloud
solution
infrastructure in companies when there is mobility. If you have, I don't know, like a big engineering company that everybody's in the same office, in the same building, but that's a hard case, you know, because the cloud there could even be worse for the latency of the answer. So that's at least what we see in the market.
Mm. Yeah, I agree.
And then you have the problem of the FUD, fear, uncertainty, and doubt.
Fear, uncertainty, and doubt.
Mm-hmm.
And the way that they don't like the cloud because they're not doing the Google screen and everything.
Yeah, that's funny because, as he said, Amazon Web Services and Google Cloud Platform, they all comply with the most highest security ISO standards. So when someone tells about that, it's like, well, you are going to have a hard time if you want to be as compliant as them in security terms, if you do it well. So security in that sense is not, well, probably in a very, very sensitive market is a concern, but for most of the use case, using the cloud is not that. It's something normal. It's not. There are very big markets working with, for example, Amazon Redshift is a huge database for, and many banks are using them to store their own sensitive data or credit cards. So.
Yeah, but actually, one of the issues with security is that let's accept that you don't trust Google and you don't trust Amazon or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
But to be honest, you don't trust more people.
Mm-hmm.
The problem is that sometimes you're talking to the CIO, so you kind of tell them that maybe you shouldn't trust yourself, you know. But really is that who do you think is gonna be more checked for his pass or whatever? Some employee you have in your company or some employee that is working at Amazon, Google or whatever. So that's one.
Yeah, I think there are many advantages and many disadvantages
disadvantages from using on cloud or on premise services, and of course the cost. Sorry, the cost to maintain an on-premise solution it's quite big, of course. But I think there are not that few cases. We are used to working in SRI with governments. Of course, they normally prefer to work on premise, even if the security checks are not that.
Yeah, but you're a company that came from that path. SRI used to do that for many, many years, and not so only on the last years. There, as Cartridge and Mapbox and other cloud service providers are working on the cloud. So your clients, of course, came from the RG server and your server side products. So
yeah, sure. But what I want to think about the security things. Of course, I'm sure. Well, I'm a really a Google fan and everything. But I know that my data is not going well, or I hope my data is not going to be stolen from his servers. But actually, I'm relying on my information stored there. And actually, I'm accepting a lot of terms of use, which I have never read, actually. Mm-hmm. But I'm sure that they will be using somehow. And, well, I agree on the normal cases in small and middle companies. Are not this shouldn't be, or it's normally an issue. And normally, this is not the case where you are going to use an on-premise solution. And as you said, all the on-premise solutions used to be way expensive, more expensive, and that's why we are also offering the RDIS online. So I don't know. I agree that keep the security on an on-premise service is not an easy task. If you have strong competitors trying to do something bad or hiring hackers to take your data, you are in a bad position to stay with an on-premise server.
It's funny because the Cartridge most viewed map was from the leak of Fastly Madison. it got like 5 million views. And it was on this.
So maybe to give a bit background between the move between on-premise and cloud, I think there's two big drivers there. The one driver is the possibilities of doing things in the cloud. That if you want to be on premise and you need to buy servers, it's going to take time until the servers arrive. You have to set them up. It's really complicated. And the second thing is cost. So if you buy servers, you're going to keep them for 3 years at least. So you have to plan ahead and know which servers you're going to need. And you have to invest all this money in buying servers. At Mapbox, we have days where we scale up 1,000 servers, 1,000 instances, do processing on them, and kill them again. So they run for 6 hours or something. And we're only built for these 6 hours, but it's 1,000 computers. That's like, I don't know how many times this room full of processing power that we're using. So this is, without the cloud, Mapbox could not exist. We could not exist as a company because we could never have the money to do all the processing we need to do to take 5 billion tweets and put them on a map, or to ingest all the satellite images that we have to show a base map of satellite imagery.
Mm-hmm. I see, for example, that a company must have clear the goal of the company and make the things that the company was created for. So I mean, for example, an energy company can have their own messengers to delivery packets and so on. But an energy, what the company have to do is to produce and deliver energy, not packets. Mm-hmm. So give messaging. Companies make this, and you.
Having expertise on messaging is not their point. So,
have a more specific question. I think like together with visualizing data, analyzing data, I think that nowadays online maps are used more and more for collecting data. No? And I'm really interested in collaborative map making. So I wanted to know if Mapbox and Cartodb are developing some tools for doing so. I think I have used some of the RDIS tools, but I still see some limitations. So that's one question, if they are developing so, if they are free. And also, I think that in order to collect data, it's for us, or in some cases, we need to create to create online platforms. No? So for me, it's quite useful when I can integrate or embed maps in a WordPress blog or website or whatever. So if you are also developing these kind of things that are making life easier for people which, like me, we are not developers, but for me, it's very easy to create a WordPress blog and then embed a map and so on. So,
so can you repeat the...
It's for the hangout.
You mean that you are asking if Cartodb and Mapbox are planning to develop applications on the web to collect data, right?
Yes, for creating collaborative online maps.
Okay.
So what do you mean by data? Is this about styling the map? Is it about putting data on the map? Is it about collecting this data? What does collaborative mapping mean to you?
Basically, like in the case of RDIS, I have used like maps that are allows public edition, but with some limitation. I mean, maybe I can edit the map, but no one can edit what I have done.
So you can add new features to the map, a point or a polygon or draw an area.
Or not only features, but maybe you can also add data related to the features and so on. No? Or maybe you can also integrate other things. No? Like I don't know if I'm uploading, for instance, cycling routes or my running routes too, if I can integrate them easily. No?
Mm-hmm. You understand?
Yes. So basically all kinds of data, but it's not about, for you, it's about sharing this with the general public, not with a team. It's not about a team working on data. Mm-hmm. It's about making data available to everyone so that you don't only work with a map, but you work with the actual data and you can alter it. Yeah. So Mapbox is not the platform for this at the moment. You can upload data, but it will only be visible to you. And we don't have facilities for sharing data with other people. We think that so far, it's tough because what's the business model of that in a way? Imagine like it's when we're talking about data sets, we should talk about really big data sets. We should talk about like gigabytes and terabytes of storage there. And where does the storage, who pays for the storage and who pays for transfer? We have been collaborating with AWS for hosting some of the data. So for example, they are hosting the Landsat imagery. So Landsat are satellites by the US government that are all the time taking images of the Earth. And I can't remember, it's a lot of data. It sends something like a terabyte or something down per day. And it was so big that we said we can't store this. AWS maybe can. So AWS actually started hosting this public data set now. And they seem like a good partner for this. We are too small. AWS does this because they want you to run your processing on AWS. So this is where the money comes from. OpenStreetMap is a big collaborative mapping effort. if your data matches the criteria of OpenStreetMap, then it is probably really well in there.
If it's public, right? It must be public.
Yeah, it must be public. It must be created by you. You must put it under the license of OpenStreetMap, which says that everyone can use it. And there are certain things that the OpenStreetMap community doesn't want. For example, timetables of buses is one example where they said this doesn't belong into this map because we can't update it well. and it's too big of data. Doesn't make sense here. On the other hand, the discussions around should ashtrays be in there, I think was, yeah, ashtrays are kind of okay. They're big ashtrays and they're important. Like, they're big garbage bins, you can map them. So there should probably be more efforts of this. So there's OpenCMAP now, for example, which is specifically for waterways. And I can imagine whatever the data set is, it makes sense to have it as a public data set that then has also a community around it, has constraints around it, what can be in the data set and what can not be, has processes for putting new data in, removing data, maintaining the data set, basically. Just having data out there isn't enough because people have to know about it, have to find it, and have to know how to use it. Mm-hmm. If you have small data sets, I think you can just, for example, put them on GitHub. That's like the easiest way, if it's a really small one. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. With CartoDB, it happens at the beginning the same, as he said, that the CartoDB as the map editor is for the what we, our users are the like the map makers, no? So you have, maybe you have an organization and you have an enterprise account, and maybe there are five users creating maps or uploading data using the editor. But that's just the part of the platform, and we have the APIs, so you can create your own application. A backend application written in PHP, Python, or whatever, and allow your general users, not the map makers, to upload data and edit the map using some middleware that you run in the middle. So, because we have an API that is basically a SQL interface to the database, so you can run an insert, an update, or a delete, but not from the browser directly, but because that's a security issue. It's, you have to use your own channel to proxy that data management from a backend, but you can do that, or upload or directly upload shape files or CSVs or Excel files using the import API. Again, using a kind of proxy if you want to expose that functionality to your users.
I just wanted to understand what's. Just to have big feedback and to be sure, which tools do you find difficult to use in the?
Not really difficult, but the thing is that I'm not focusing on. I want to share data not to all public, but to a number of people. It wasn't exactly this, but the idea of creating like a small OpenStreetMap projects. I mean, for instance, I've been working with cooperation groups in Latin America, and in my case, I wanted to create a community of people. Was just collecting data from retail, from whatever. Mm-hmm. So it is necessary to open to the public. So whoever I am, is maybe it doesn't belong to my team, but it's just getting to the website and just kind of. But the thing is that when I have done that, sometimes it's not, the data is uploaded, but maybe not the way you are representing the data. So there are still some features that are not very working very well, I think. And still, I think that there are many functionalities in RGS, RGS Online, but only for the professional person. I mean, so I wanted to know if maybe there are other options from others just to create these collaborative online maps, because the free version of RGIS is quite limited, no? Unless you are a developer. Because these pre-built applications are quite complete, it's true, but then I think that if you want to go further, either you are a developer or you don't have many options, I can understand that. But I didn't know if the others were doing so. And I think it's still a field that I think is going to grow in the next years, because maybe, okay, I think that in my case also I try to contribute to OpenStreetMap, but there are many initiatives from different people that just can start their own small project. Maybe I have like a small enterprise and I want to create a map or with my neighbors or something. So very little projects, no? For these kind of things, I think these platforms are quite useful.
Yeah. Regarding your other question about publishing maps on a blog, I think the three of us have like the typical embed option, so you can have like a snippet that you can put on your WordPress, or maybe in WordPress. I think in WordPress.com it's limited. But
no, in for, your ORG.
But if you are running your own WordPress, you can set up your own embeds, like the script or an iframe, and it's pretty, because it's a very common use case, so it's not really difficult to do that.
Anyway, I also want to comment that when you have this kind of difficulties, the purpose of the GeoDevelopers community is to be able to request help, because we are there to try to remove all the barriers you have with. I think we are all there, so in order to help you try to figure out.
I want to add, because I think that something very similar that you have asked is the accessibility mapping party with OpenStreetMap. Mm-hmm. That is a very narrow project in just a neighborhood, and you with the neighborhood, with the neighbors, upload one specific
tag. Yes.
Tag that is a wheelchair or accessibility thing with the local businesses, and it's quite easy. But I don't know if you want more complicated thing, no?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
It's an idea. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Related to what you were saying about OpenStreetMap, I didn't know that the OpenStreetMap didn't want some data because it's too complicated, like the timetable for the buses. I know this project, and that's something that we would like to that he added in the RDIs online. So that's why OpenStreetMap, it's a platform that I really like, and I think it's very, very useful. But if they have some limitation on the data that you can upload there, then it's true that it needs something else, like to link, for example, the population characteristics of the neighborhoods or something more complicated than just the dot and if it's a sub and the name of the sub. If you want more complicated or more complex data, there is some room for improvement.
Mm-hmm. I would maybe like to add that one of the big values from OpenStreetMap is the fact that it's a community that is living, and there's disputes happening, and people are contributing the whole time. So the technical side of, for example, when you say sharing census data, sharing population data, the one thing is sharing this data once, and then the other thing is maintaining it, having a discussion what should be in there, verifying the data. So all these things around that are non-technical are actually way harder than the technical part. Mm. Putting data out there, like if it's a lot of data, it's the question who pays for it. But if it's not a lot of data, it's like not that big of a problem. OpenStreetMap runs on something, I don't know what, I think the last funding run was like £50,000 per year for the servers. And this includes paying people to look after the servers as well. So it's actually a cheap project to run in a way. For what it does, it's really, really cheap.
From the value,
From the value that everyone gets from this. So the harder part is having people who have an incentive to work on this. And I think it's important for every community to protect itself as well from making sure that it continues to follow its core vision, goal, or principles. And so the OpenStreetMap community has to say, we cannot have public transport timetables. It doesn't fit with our data model. It doesn't fit with our community. Somebody needs to do open transport
tables
or whatever it's going to be called. And somebody needs to work on this. And then a new community will form around this. So, for example, we're also part of the Open Traffic initiative, which... Open Traffic IO, which works on opening up traffic data, both historic and live dev traffic data, to make it consumable for everyone.
Mm-hmm. So, do you see the skills
Can you repeat the question?
Do you see that the skills needed to be a developer now changing due to web mapping?
A common developer, you mean if the skills for a common developer is changing with the...
For a GIS developer, somebody who wants to develop applications that will use geographic and geographic
information. Yeah, it's been always a very...
Let's repeat the question.
Yeah, sorry.
If you see...
No, we should repeat the question.
Yeah, for the Hangouts. For the Hangouts.
Yeah, he's asking about if the skills of the developers working with geospatial stuff are changing over the last years, right? And will change. Well, I think it's a very fast pacing technology area. So we are moving from, it's very different from 10 years ago, way different when I started, I mean, on this market. But I think it's getting easier, probably, for many of us. If they work with our products, it's easier. You don't have to know, because, well, I'm a cartographer, so I know all about projections and
yeah.
And that
that's
kind of...
that's the example. Like, a web developer who wants to put something on their website shouldn't have to know about projections.
Yeah.
Everyone should know about projections, of course, and how they distort reality. But they shouldn't have to worry about it if they don't want to.
But that was not the case 10 years ago, because you were with very specific tools. They were very complicated. You need to know about projections and data types and many different stuff, because you were living with all the stack. But nowadays, if you use a web service like Algiers Map or Soccer TV, you are only living with some APIs and maybe your data model, but not of course the decision about the rendering, but the symbology and the cartographic decision about how they are displayed, but not how they are stored or how they are moved from the database to the rendering or anything. So it's getting easier, I think.
I agree, and I also see on the ArcGIS side that the languages has been changing. Some technologies has been deprecated, and now we are becoming to a huge wave. We are moving all with the JavaScript language that.
Mm-hmm.
I'm a really fan for JavaScript. We are on Python, and of course, I think also that a developer shouldn't worry about the projection. I should know it, but I also think that we are now starting to homogenize or starting to work in the same way and the same languages, and it's going to be really important for in the future for every developer to be able to,
mm-hmm.
to work.
Well, still, because Karen is going to kill me if I don't say that, because she's a teacher in cartographic engineering. So I think having a cartographic engineer or someone or a geographer, someone very specialized on visualization makes a difference on big projects.
Yeah.
Maybe not for anything, but I think having someone that has those skills is like having a designer on a project. If you don't have a designer, your web application is going to look crap. But
yeah.
And your maps is going to be the same. Sometimes
I wasn't
is,
saying yeah,
no,
thing.
No. But I'm stating it because
yeah.
I think. It,
I agree. Yeah, when I saw the project, well, the different segments of people who needs who have different needs of geographic or knowledge, I'm of course professionals, all related with professional stuff. Every developer should have a cartographer.
Yeah.
If you are going to need high level skills of
mm-hmm.
these things, because I'm noticing it, because I have never studied anything
mm-hmm.
about this. I'm now facing how to make applications, and I know how to do that, but I don't know what to do actually.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how to handle this data, or that's why in the community I'm also trying to bring together developers with cartographers, with environmental engineers, and with every kind of profile, so we can work together in
mm-hmm.
doing great application and collaboration.
Maybe to add to this, open source has been great, and open data has made it way easier on the one hand to work with map data. All of a sudden you can have a base map of the world that you can work with yourself and you don't have to license it for insane amounts of money that nobody has. And the second thing is that it might also get a bit complicated still, because we're still in a phase where a lot has happened. In the last like 5 years, 3 years, technology is shifting a lot. A lot of things are working, and now we're homogenizing towards, like, the scene is kind of coming together again. So I think mapping in 5 years will be so much easier than it is today, because we have cleared up how technology works. There's going to be way more stuff that can work without code as well. Like the one-click map will be way more common and will work with whatever data set you throw at it. And also, we're now at a point where with cloud computing, but also generally with just way more computing to our availability, we hit a point where working with the world, with the data of the world, is feasible. So it's not a problem anymore to load 250 gigabytes of map data into memory. That was unthinkable. Like, you could not afford a server some years ago that has so much memory. It was insane to think of. And just today we had this thought experiment. So what do we do if we have a server with 2 terabytes of memory? Like, how will this change how we do map serving? So there might be like the tipping point now where you can work with the world and it's not that hard anymore.
When it changes the way you think about your data, and it's not anymore about the size of the memory, but other problems that will come.
And it's the same. So you could file this under big data. That is transforming so many things around us at the moment. And the same happens with mapping and with location data.
Actually, I'm thinking on the one project we have, the Esri Angular. I don't know if you have been watching it, but this is the way I think with Angular, with web components of these kind of technologies, you will see how almost anyone will be able to stick together Lego pieces, and make maps, because it's really easy. They have all the behavior and everything. It's hidden for the developer, and you just need to write a markup, like five lines of HTML code, and link all the things together. I think we are going to move in this direction. All the development. Developing technologies are going to be in that way.
And again, is that common quote about the spatial is special and it's not special, because we are having that kind of the one-click thing about the analyzes your data and propose your maps is also coming to Google spreadsheets. So it analyzes your spreadsheet and propose to you maybe a graph or a way to format the conditioning format your cells. So it's not something about just only on mapping, but it's happening in many other areas that where we are having a next level of abstraction of how we use our tools. So it's just something else, not that special.
Someone from the Hangout? You are very quiet. I know it's 20 to 9. I don't know. We didn't set up a finish day hour, I think. Or I did.
Maybe we'll go and drink something now.
Yeah.
Yeah, if you don't have any question, I think we can keep the conversation with one beer in the other room. Thank you, Jansa. Jansa, you don't have any question? Pedro, Noel, someone there? Okay, so thank you and see you next talk. Hopefully Sunday here in Madrid or wherever.
Thank you for making this in English.
Yeah, we did our best.
I think
we're
in
immersion
course.
Bye.
Bye.
So let's move to the other room.